Thank you all for coming and for having us. And I really want to thank Susan for bringing back the symposium. I didn't make all of the old ones back in the day. Probably many of you made some of them. At least I made a few of them and really enjoyed it. And she has done a lot of legwork to bring this back. She wrote the grant to get funding for it. She writes the grant every year to get funding for Boreas Pass Railroad Day. She is one of the movers and shakers. Give her a round, please. Thank you. Today we're going to talk about, I didn't know what to call it, so I looked at the schedule she wrote up, and this was the name we came up with. The Como Railroad Revitalization. Next slide. We'll talk about the past, what's led up to today, what's been happening this week. An awful lot has happened this week. We've had 7 straight days of track laying down there. And I'm glad this is the 7th day. I'm burned out. Last year we had 6 volunteer work days. This year we had 6 volunteer work days, but between 2 of them, we decided to go all week because several people said, I really wanted to do this. I drove a long way and I want to do more than one day. Can we do a week? So we tried it and it worked out great. The lowest number we had during the weekdays was 12 volunteers. And we'll also talk about the future. Next slide. The impetus for this, or the idea to do something with the Como Depot, came from the Buena Vista Depot. This all happened, and Tim and Betty Daniels are back there. They were a big part of this. I'll just show a few slides. Next slide, show you what we started with. This was the office building of the Woodland Brook Cabins down in Buena Vista. It was moved from its original site to the Woodland Brook Cabins and then moved again. What year was that, Tim? That we actually moved it to 2003, 4, 5, somewhere in there? That far back? Long time ago. Interesting story, what happened, there was another building connected to this that came later on this side, and a fire started in that and did damage to this building. Insurance company came along and looked at it and said, here's a check for $5,000, I'd knock it down if I were you. And luckily they contacted Buena Vista Heritage, who were very interested in saving it. So it was moved to its present location on the northwest corner of, what is it, Highway 24 and Main Street. And you look at this, and I remember thinking, holy cow, are we seriously going to try to do something with that? Well, this made the Como Depot look like it was already finished. Next slide. Some big cranes were involved. Here it is being set on its new foundation, which it didn't even have before, a concrete foundation. And one more slide on this depot, and that's what they ended up with. And it's beautiful. If you haven't been down there, you got to check it out. And this all happened before 2008 when we started on the Como Depot. And this gave me the thought of anything's possible. And originally, all we wanted to do in 2007, before David bought the hotel, was stabilize it. Next slide. Okay, I'll get to this one in a minute. We just wanted to stabilize it. It was very close to falling down. The front of it had sunk 2 feet. And it was racked at 20 degrees, and you could tell it was one or two winters away from disappearing. And the previous owner, maybe many of you remember them, I had approached them in the summer of 2007 with permission from our historical society to spend the money, do the labor, we'd be fully insured, and stabilize the building, and we'd do it for free. All he had to do was nod his head up and down, and he went, no, thank you. And I thought, wow, that's it, we've lost the building. The first of many miracles happened the following February when David came along and bought the depot, and he was very interested in saving it. So in 2008, we stabilized the building. We'll get to that slide in a minute. This is the earliest known photo of Como. We did a lot of archaeological study and came up with 1883, and then somebody noticed it's on the bottom, 1883. So anyway, this is a George Mellon photograph. And if anybody knows of an earlier one, Como started in 79, but we know of no other photographs older than 83. There's the Gilman original hotel, built during 1880, opened January 1st, 1881, New Year's Day. The following year, the railroad put the extension on it, and you can see back then the depot, today's depot, was connected to the hotel. In 1885, the Pacific Hotel Company came along, much like the Harvey House set up on the Santa Fe on a smaller scale. And what they did was they knocked down this little porch and built a really nice porch through over the front of it, put a nice roof on this flat roof here, and it was a very pretty building. And they actually moved the depot about 15 feet away to the south where it is today. presumably we thought they didn't want that wooden building catching fire and doing damage to their brick building, when ironically the opposite happened. The brick building burned down in 1896, November 96, and the depot somehow survived. And there's the roundhouse. In this picture it says 2 years old, 1881. And the tenement building back there, the foundation ruins are still there today. But that was 1883, and if anybody finds an older photograph, please let me know. Next slide. This was a Forest Service photograph, aerial survey they were doing from 1938. And okay, there's the hotel and the depot. Highway 8, way before 285 came along. And the roundhouse is over here in the tenement building. And that was the year the tracks were pulled up. Just prior to that, next slide. End of an era, April 10th, 1937, the last passenger train had come in from Leadville, and it would back out past the depot out to the Y over opposite Elkhorn Road, and then turn around and head down to Denver. That was the last passenger train on the South Park line. I think the next day, Tom, you could correct me on this, I think the next day was the last scheduled freight train. And after that, it was just movements of equipment, and the following year, the scrap trains came through all summer long as they started tearing up the track from Fremont Pass at the Climax Mine all the way back through Como and down the Platte, all the way to South Fork, I think it was, or South Platte. And a few years later, they tore that track up. Next slide. Here's what we started with. Next slide. I'll think about this. David came here in February of 08 when he saw this with snow on the ground, and he bought this. And you gotta wonder, is he a man of great vision or the village idiot? Well, I think recent history has proven he's a man with a great vision. Next slide. A couple of months before that other picture was taken, here's a very poignant photo of a snowdrift up to the ticket window. It was in bad shape. Next slide. This would have been 2009 when Mike Pershbacher and his crew of Older Than Dirt Construction started the stabilization or the rehab process. This is what we did in June of 2008. Dug some holes, poured some concrete, 4x4s to hold up the front of the building so it couldn't lean anymore, so it couldn't sink anymore. We patched up half the roof that was missing with this same pattern corrugated tin, and we boarded up the windows to keep those snowdrifts away from the ticket window. And back then it was just, I didn't want it to fall down. I never dreamed, I have to admit, I'm not a man of great vision. I'd never dreamed you'd see what you're gonna see today out there just 10 years later. So I've got a few more slides of this process. Next slide. Here's Mike and his crew. You can see the brand new joist that had sunk down into the dirt, the old ones anyway, and had rotted away. This building never really had a foundation as we know it today. It was on some square timbers and some tree trunks, most of which had rotted away and disappeared, and the joist went down into the dirt, and you know what happens when wood ends up in dirt for that many decades. So they replaced some, sistered up others, and did it all the way across, and then put a header underneath all along, and went back and forth with bottle jacks and jacked it back up to level again. Next slide. You can see the money we got from the grants made basically what's today History Colorado dictated. It had to have the same kind of foundation. So today it's got big, like 14x14 timbers on a stone base on the virgin dirt. And Mike said that'll last another 100 years. So 100 years from now, your great-great-grandchildren will listen to somebody else standing up here how they rescued that depot. Next slide. I'm sure several of you saw this before we started. This is what the building looked like before the restoration started. That is the ticket window, of course. There were many layers of paint. Today it's a different color, but we had a professional paint sampling process done. Went down to the first color or coat of paint, and that's what's on the building today. Next slide. This is where the station agent sat, and the ceiling was falling in. Mike tied it up. It was in bad shape, and probably all of you saw it at one point or another. Next slide. This is an interesting slide. These in the middle here, this is the original nailers for the original roof, and the bright colored ones are the ones we had to replace. This is the tin that the railroad put up to replace the original wood shake that it was built with in 79. Somewhere around 1900, they put this tin up, and the brighter tin is what we replaced in the summer of 08 to stabilize it. Same pattern, but it didn't have that 100 plus year old rusty patina on it. And this is the new replacement wood shake roof going on and working its way over, which is what's on there today. Next slide. Some of the siding going up on the north end, and this is kind of interesting because all the other sides of the building have vertical slats, and this has horizontal slats, and this is where it was attached to what became the Pacific Hotel back in the day. Next slide. The freight room, the Cooley brothers took it over right after the railroad abandoned it, and this was a double door for a two-bay garage in the freight room. So Mike had to rebuild that wall. The remains of the original freight door were still there, so he got that working again and reinstalled the windows that had long been boarded over. Next slide. The south end, for lack of a better term, the line shack, had been rebuilt from scratch. That had collapsed and disappeared decades ago. Next slide. Okay, this shows the timbers that are underneath it. That's okay, you just reminded me. I'm gonna put mine on vibrate before mine goes off. And next slide. The pilings for the platform out front. And we, go back one please. We hope to, the original platform went around the back of the depot where the line shack is, and right now it goes up to this edge. Originally it went all the way to the north end of the hotel, and we hope to recreate that in the future. Next slide. And this is what it looks like today. A little bit nicer than that earlier view you saw. And we're still working on the displays and whatnot, and the furniture that's in there. It's an ongoing project. Next slide. And the rear freight door was again reconstructed. That was long gone. But the reason I showed this is kind of what it looked like back in the day with the period crates and milk can and that incredible view that hasn't changed a bit. Next slide. Some updates we put in. It never had electricity, but now it does. There's an outlet in every room for future use. We're not using them all yet, but for lighting displays and whatnot. Next slide. And we even got, we call this tongue-in-cheek a movie theater, but it's a computer, it's connected to the internet, and of course that's just a picture that we threw up there. But we can show movies like Engine Number 9 going to Leadville, the Tatum film. You can do research on it. We've got a data bank of photographs on here, so anybody that's visiting can use this. Next slide. This says a lot. This is Nyla, David's dog back when he first started. I'm gonna call it Queen Nyla. She's thinking this depot is going to the dogs, and unfortunately, before we finished restoring it, I think the trauma proved too much and she took the last train west, and she's up there keeping an eye on things now. Her successor, next slide, King Shadow, is real happy as he surveys his kingdom here. So this was taken last year. This is the Ryder Gundle. It was the first car delivered here that came from the Georgetown Loop. And you can see the shingles were done and the roof, the chimneys had been restored. They disappeared just from the wind down to underneath the roof. The wind just beat up the concrete in between them, and every year a couple more bricks would fall off. And as soon as you got inside the roof line, these chimneys, the original chimneys, look like new. They're still there. That tells you what the winters are like here, which you all know. Next slide. A few things we've done along the way. We restored the original crossbucks. These boards are these boards, just repainted. And we restriped the concrete post. And out in my truck, I've got a replica Colorado 8 sign that we're gonna put up on the other side of the crossbucks, which we have in a photograph where it was originally. So don't get confused, it's not really Colorado 8, but it's gonna recreate the scene. Next slide. Things are moving along, the platform's done, we haven't laid any track yet. This was probably 14 or early 15.
That looks like 15. 15, I'd say 15.
Early 15 before Boreas Pass Railroad days. We did lay that year track right in front here. And even then, as recently as 15, I never dreamed we'd have a steam engine and lots more track and a turntable that works. This is like the proverbial snowball off the top of the mountain. There's an avalanche down there now somewhere. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and amazing things keep happening. Next slide. Before and after. There's your proof. David is a man of great vision. He's not the village idiot. Next slide. August, was it 19th? I forget.
2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Yeah.
The day we dedicated the depot, and we had some folks dress up in period dress just for the effect. And it was a wonderful, wonderful day. And even on that day, never dreamed we'd be hearing a real steam whistle and a steam engine moving back and forth and all the things that have happened since very quickly. Next slide. That particular year, our historical society, Denver South Park and Pacific Historical Society, held our annual convention here, so they'd be here for the convention, and that's just a group photo. We have about 310 members now, and we usually have about 80 folks at each convention. Next slide. We put this interpretive sign up, and that has proved very popular. People are stopping there all the time to get an idea of what it is they're looking at. Next slide. It's also listed on the National Register of Historic Places. This is on the front of the depot. Next slide. We have an authentic hand car. Todd Hackett built that. It's based on an original, same design, and we give rides on it today. This will be running on Boreas Pass Railroad Day this year, August 18th, third Saturday in August every year. Happens to be the 18th this year. Next slide. This is pretty cool. One of our members, and he's on the board of directors, Jason Mediette, built this replica push car based on a photograph taken over by, it was Pat Gibney's shop, and he had two of them out front. So it looks just like the originals. I don't know what happened to the originals, but this has proved very useful as we work on the track to haul tools back and forth. When we first started, there were two lengths of track, and from here to end of track was back to Tim and Betty Daniels, and now it's like a quarter of a mile away and getting longer all the time. Next slide. And we got a speeder. We break that out once in a while. David and I and one other guy bought this from a private collector. And this is from the Tacoma power plant on the Durango and Silverton. If you've ever ridden that train, they pointed that out to you. 1952. Same year as me. Next slide. This we pulled out of the Platte River just below the Strancha Dam. This is a circa 1900 coupler pocket. This part goes under the car, and it's a link and pin system. And this was replaced with today's modern knuckle coupler. Tom, where are you? Around 1905 or so?
I don't know.
Early 1900s. So this is probably from the 1890s. It was probably part of a wreck. It was in the creek, literally just below today's Strancha Dam. If you go up from Waterton, I think it's 5 or 6 miles up. And anyway, that'll be on display at the roundhouse. Next slide. And we got the end of an original 1878 Denver South Park and Pacific passenger coach. It was number 3, called the Geneva. That's a good picture. Tim, Betty, what are you laughing at? Anyway, it's just the end of it. This sat out in the field in eastern plains of Colorado for many, many years, and the center of the car had collapsed just from being neglected. And somebody chainsawed both ends, and Mike Pinnell put this thing together. He's got one end up in Cheyenne, Wyoming, and we got the other end. We're not planning to restore it or anything, but it is an original artifact that held passengers from Denver through Como to both Gunnison and Leadville over many, many years. Next slide. Working on the railroad. This would have been last year, 16, or 2 years ago now, 16, extending from the end of track that was at the depot. We're working our way over to the turntable and said, hey, that's complete. The turntable was restored last year, literally finished the night before Boreas Pass Railroad Day. 9 o'clock at night under car headlights, and it finally got finished. Next slide. Looking the other direction, this is the lead down to the turntable in front of the roundhouse, and this is the old main line to Gunnison. And today, this week, we extended it all the way down to the old water tank, which is behind the roundhouse, and it's going to go a little bit further. Next slide. And looking the other way, there's the speeder making a run past the depot. I'll talk about the future plans, where we're going with the track in this direction. Next slide. This is a circa 1885 classic photo. It's been published a lot, but it's a great photograph of the roundhouse around 1885. The turntable has been resurrected. We haven't finished planking it yet. We're going to put the planks in, as well as the two push bars, one there and one on this end. Right now you have to get down on the pit to push it, but probably within the next few weeks we'll have that process complete. And next slide. If you're wondering what the roundhouse looked like on the inside, this is a model, but a very, very nice detailed model. I threw this in. And you can see the overhead shafts and pulleys, and there were belts going down to lathes and drill presses and all sorts of things. Originally, it was just a roundhouse with six stalls in 1881 when they decided to go over the High Line to Breckenridge and all the way up the 10 mile to Leadville. They turned this more into of a machine shop. It had a wooden floor, which we hope to restore one day. Anyway, this gives you an idea of what it looked like back in the day. Next slide. October 2014, we took out the turntable that had been sitting here for 25 years. Bill Kazel got it back 25 years before this was taken. He said it was exactly 25 years it had been sitting there. It came from a field near Georgetown, and he just dumped it in the pit and it sat there. And now we were getting ready to restore the turntable, so we lifted it out so we could dig out the pit, find the center stone, and you'll see some more pictures in a moment of rebuilding the turntable. And again, it got done the night before Boreas Pass Railroad Day.
Is that the original turntable?
That's a good question. It may be, we're not sure. It matches the pictures exactly. It came from in the field in Georgetown. Prior to that, it had been separated, the two halves, and was supporting a roof at a garage down in Denver. Where that came from, we don't know. It might be, it may not be. But we have lots of photographs of turntables, and you can see differences in all of them. And this matches the original pictures of the Como turntable. We just can't prove it.
Not the one that was in there in 1938.
This would have been the first one.
Yeah, the first one that was either replaced in 1908 or 1910.
There were two turntables in Como. If this is the original, it's the original, the first generation. The records indicate it was either 08 or 1910 that they put in the second one that was pulled out in 38, and I don't know where that one went. Next slide. Here you can see the pit being dug out, and you can see how much dirt had accumulated with grass and whatnot. This is the original pivot stone, and the original concrete lintels with timbers in between them that had deteriorated so much, we ended up knocking them all out and putting in new ones. Next slide. The turntable bearing, I call this miracle number 38. Steve O'Connell from Paonia called me up one day and said, we have a turntable bearing, could you use it? And I'm like, are you kidding me? Where did this come from? An elderly friend of his had it in his barn for about 45 years. It was a DNRG turntable at the end of a mine spur near Paonia. And many years ago, they pulled the turntable out and put it across a creek, and people are still driving across it today. And he had this bearing, and he put it in his barn, and it sat there for decades. And his elderly friend, whose name I can't remember, said, Steve, find a home for this thing before I kick the bucket and it disappears. So he called the Colorado Railroad Museum in Golden, and they said, we don't need it, but try the guys in Como. And that's when I went, are you kidding me? It's about 4 feet in diameter. There's two halves, upper and lower. And then if you take the top half off with a crane, that's heavy as can be, there's a bunch of tapered Timken roller bearings in there. So we cleaned everything up, put it back together, filled it full of grease and lube oil, and turns easily. Even with a locomotive on the turntable, it turns very easily. And I could go on and on all day about stories like this, where people just came out of the woodwork with something we really needed. There's a real synergy going on here, and I got this theory about the Como ghosts are driving all this. Next slide. You can see them here rebuilding the timbers with concrete in between. Next slide. And rebuilding the center pivot.
That was last year, wasn't it?
2 years.
No, last year.
Was it last year?
Yeah.
This would be spring last year.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, last year. Go back one. The ring rail, too, was another donation that came out of nowhere. It was $7,000, and I don't know the guy's name offhand. Do you?
He owns the 100 Mine near Silverton, and I forgot his name.
He heard about all this and wrote a check to some refinery or smelter or whatever in Portland, Oregon, and had this rail made exactly to our specifications, to our curvature, and sent it out on a truck, and we just bolted it in place, spiked it in place, and miracle number 42. Next slide. Here they are putting in these big I-beams in between the two halves of the turntable so it would set on that bearing. Next slide. Here it is installed before we put the ties across it. And Kathy Brannigan, the wife of Charles Brannigan, who owns the roundhouse, went down into the pit, and we didn't know, you know, first time, is it going to take a huge effort to move this? We didn't know. She put her thumb on it and pushed it with her thumb. Next slide. Putting the timbers on it, nearing completion. Next slide. Just before the sun set, this was the day before Boreas Pass Railroad Day. Worked till 9 o'clock that night to get it ready for the next day. Next slide. And here you go. Was it worth it? I look at this and I think, are you kidding me? It was worth it. And the track into stall number 5, which is where what we call Klondike Kate now is housed, we finished that day with help from the crowd. It was like a Tom Sawyer whitewashing the fence thing. We're going to give a track laying demonstration. How about everybody here helping out? And it worked. Story on the locomotive real quick. 1912 Baldwin, built in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. For built brand new for the Klondike Mines Railway up in the Yukon Territory. And they only had it for a year or two, and I guess they raised a lot of capital, but something went wrong with the finances and they went out of business in a couple of years. Maybe the mine played out, I don't know. Sat in the weeds to World War II, the government took it over and put it over in the other narrow gauge up there, the White Pass and Yukon between Skagway, Alaska, and Whitehorse, Yukon. And they used it during the war, and that railroad used it up until early 50s. And then sat in their weeds for a while, and somebody brought it down to the lower 48. And it bounced around half a dozen little railroads, and some operated it, some didn't. Then the Georgetown Loop bought it about 4 years ago. They had it for a few years, but didn't use it. And Dr. Brannigan and his wife Kathy went over and looked at it, and felt like they gotta have it, like a lightning bolt hit them. They gotta have it, so they sent it up to a machine shop in Cheyenne, Wyoming. They rebuilt the boiler and sent it down, and we got it running 2 days before Boreas Pass Railroad Day, a day before the turntable was done. And it had lots of steam leaks and still needs a lot of attention, which is being dealt with right now. So it'll be in much better shape for this year, but it did run that weekend. If anybody was here, I'm sure you'll never forget it. It was emotional, it really was amazing. Next slide. Denver Brass, Dr. and Mrs. Brannigan are both tuba players. That's how they met. And the Denver Brass came up and put on a nice show for us. John Phillips, Sousa Marches, you know, period music. And they did such a good job, we found out later, it wasn't their first rodeo. Next slide. Back in the day, same exact spot, right in front of the freight door.
No snow.
Next slide. This was Boreas Pass Railroad Day with a locomotive once again in front of the depot, first time in 80 years or whatever it was. one of our members built this replica. It's called a train order board, and the mechanism goes inside and down to a lever over here. And back in the day, he would turn it 90 degrees, and if the engineer saw the white, that was supposed to mean continue, don't stop. And if he flipped it 90 degrees and you saw the red, that meant stop and come in and talk to me. Get your further train orders. And this is really cool. This is an 1870s freight wagon from the Pacific Express Company, which later on ended up in the Railway Express Agency Company and
American
Express ultimately. But this dates from the 1870s, and the two guys, Bob and Don Shank, from down in South Fork, they had the railroad that went up to Creed, part of the old Denver and Rio Grande. They found this, restored it, and brought it in on Boreas Pass Railroad Day. And I'm salivating over this thing, and they said, oh, by the way, it's yours. They donated it to us. So we keep it in the freight room where it belongs, and we do have historical photos. Not this wagon, but this type of wagon was used in Como, so it belongs here. Miracle number 93. Next slide. This was this week. There's the cart we were using. We extended the track two lengths past the depot, past the depot to in front of the hotel. Part of the reason we did that, just because we wanted to go further in that direction, but the engine with the rider gun on the back, if it went all the way to the end of track where it was at the end of the depot, didn't quite clear the switch. It was hard to throw the switch with a gondola sitting on top. Now we got plenty of room. Next slide. This is really cool. This is a Colorado and Southern original gondola. You can see the CNS logo there, number 4319. It's the only remaining Colorado and Southern gondola that we're aware of. And up until Wednesday, it had been sitting above Central City for decades. It used to be in Central City when the locomotive and the combination car, which are on a pedestal in front of a casino now, and they took this car and put it in a park 2 miles above Central City. And it sat there not being cared for at all. It was nice and new when they put it there, and it just deteriorated. So we went to them and made a pitch, our society and the South Park Rail Society, a parallel nonprofit. And we made a deal. We got it on a 10-year lease for $1 a year, and we have to restore it and repaint it. A few pieces of wood need replaced, a couple pieces of metal, and the knuckles on the couplers are gone for some reason. But we'll fix all that, and we're going to use this car in a train and repaint it and re-letter it. So we've got it for 10 years, and it's an original Colorado Southern car. And that arrived just this past Wednesday. Next slide. Here we are working on the Gunnison, Maine. This car in the background is an original Colorado and Southern boxcar, but it's standard gauge. It never came through Como. The CNS system ran from Wyoming all the way down to Texas along the Front Range, and it was all standard gauge. And the South Park line was a narrow gauge subsidiary that they owned. We use it for a toll car now. Next slide. Future plans. We're going to lay more track. We're going to rebuild a trestle. I'll talk about that in a minute. And a water tank, and a few of the roundhouse stalls. In addition to the six stalls that are still there, the original six, over the 1880s and 1890s, the railroad added 13 more wooden bays, and those are long gone today. But we hope to rebuild a few of them because we need more garage space for what's coming. Next slide. This is a complicated map, but it's a 1918 Interstate Commerce Commission railroad map. These are the original six stalls, and you can see the 13 that were added later and are gone completely today. The tenement house, the coal dock, the hotel and the depot. And let's see, the yellow is what we're hoping to do this year, and we're working on that right now, extending the Gunnison, Maine. Blue will be in the future, it'll go out to the edge of the property. Green is what we did last year. There was quite an extensive track system. We're not going to restore all of it, but more than is there today. And then we're going to go in the other direction. Next slide. Part of the same map, 1918, this is what you were looking at a moment ago. The original grade, just past the depot or the hotel, went down into Park Gulch, which is what this is. And it went across a small trestle right there, and then it climbed up the other side, and you can see it clearly today, the line out there. And right here was what they called the King Y. The main line went through it, down to Jefferson and Kenosha and on down to Denver. And this went down all the way to the King Mines, which the ruins of which are still there today. And 285 is basically right here today. But we hope to build out to the Y, and that would give us about a 1 mile run with the ability to turn the locomotive at both ends, so it's always going in the right direction. Turn on the turntable at this end and on the Y at this end. You know, people show up and they say, when are you going over Boreas Pass and whatnot? Well, a few years ago, they said, when are you going to have a steam engine? And I laughed just like that, and here we go. Right now, this is our five-year plan, if you will, and we don't cross any roads, which is huge. If you cross a road, even the one through Como, you open a Pandora's box of federal regulation. Don't want to go there, but maybe the next crew, your kids or whatever, will go, let's keep going and play that game and deal with the feds and all that. But this is what we have in mind right now. Next slide. Again, 1938 aerial photo, you can see what it did. Here's a Y there. 285 comes right across here today. And the Elkhorn Road goes down here. And this would be the main line, or the other line, up over Boreas past the Breckenridge. We might go past this switch out here a little ways to the edge of your property. Well, you can't go very far.
We can go a few hundred yards.
A few hundred yards, perhaps. But that would be a dead end. Then there's another property that if we ever got permission to go onto his property, we could go. It kind of does a turn and then tries to cross the dirt road just outside of Como. And then it goes on the other side and up past the cemetery. Again, we would stop there, but we could lay more track and have plenty of room to store cars or whatever. But for now, this is the plan. Next slide.
And there it is.
There's the switch right there. This would be going up to Boreas Pass, and this would be going back to Denver. This train could be arriving, or it could be going to Denver, which it would back up. It would pull in from Leadville, and there was no way to turn the whole train. So it would back up through this switch and back down across the trestle and up to the Y, turn the whole train on the Y, and then go in the right direction down to Denver. That's how they did it. And you can see, this is the platform that we're hoping to rebuild in front of the hotel. Next slide. Here's a shot of the trestle. So here's a train stuck in the snow, which happened a lot back then, that was trying to go to Jefferson and Denver. And this is a train up on the main line to Breckenridge and Boreas Pass. And the next one I want to show you is just a close-up of this trestle. Next slide. Pretty simple. I mean, we're not going to do this in an afternoon, that's for sure. But as trestles go, this was a modest-sized trestle. Four vertical bents, they call them. And there was a wooden wall at each end to keep the dirt back. So we have to recreate that. Next slide. This is a 1929 view with a depot behind us. So we're looking out on the Gunnison Main here towards Gunnison. And this is the turntable lead that we've rebuilt. And this would have been a late 30s picture, 37, 36 perhaps. Went actually through the wooden stall to the turntable. These two little boxcars are still there. They've been there all along. You've probably seen them. And you can see what looks like a switch, but it has no moving parts. This was a garage, if you will. These two boxcars had doors at the ends, which you can still see today. And that was the repair shop for the hand cars and later on the motorized hand cars, which we call speeders. They would work on them in there. And to get them back on the track, they would just lift up one end at a time and move it over. They weren't that heavy. So there were no moving parts on this. And this is the water tank we hope to rebuild. And for a while, they had two water tanks. There's one back here, which will be a close-up in the next slide. There it is back there. This is the one we hope to rebuild and actually use it. Next slide. This is a restored St. Louis built Colorado and Southern original boxcar number 8027. That is coming back to Como probably this fall. I'm not sure when. It might be next year. Jason Midyet acquired this locally, took it out to where he's living now in northeastern Kansas and restored it. And he wants it to come back, and it's going to come back. And this is a car that will run in a train. It's not quite finished here. He has to put the truss rods back in and a coupler, but you can see it's really nice. Okay. Next slide. I just found out about this about a week ago. This is a Rio Grande Southern passenger car. I think it's number 256. Does that sound right, David? Do you know?
I can't remember.
They're working on, this is owned by the Shank brothers that donated the Pacific Express freight car to us. And they're working on a deal to bring this back to Como. It needs a lot of work, but we hope to have a passenger car in our train someday.
Where is that now?
Monte Vista. No, they live in Monte Vista, but I think this might be down by Dolores or something. I'm not sure where this picture was taken.
South Fork?
Is that where it is? I'm not sure where it is. South and west of here at the moment. But it's, they're making a deal. They said it's coming back to Como. Next slide. This was a late 36, 37 view of the roundhouse. Here's where the stone roundhouse ends. And there were, at this time, about three bays that had been rebuilt from a fire in 1935. And this is what we hope to recreate. Next slide. We're not planning to do all 13 wooden bays, but maybe your great-grandchildren. So here we are, Back to the Future. If you want to know more information, that's the website of my organization, the Denver South Park Pacific Historical Society. Lots of photos, lots of information.